Hey everybody, thanks for joining us on Sunday for our session. And so let's go ahead and take a moment and close your eyes and just reflect on the week and the things going on in your life. The good, the bad, the neutral. Just keep your eyes closed and reflect. If you have a prayer, need for healing, hold the issue or the subject in your heart. Take a long, slow, deep breath in through the nose. Pause and gently exhale through the mouth. Again, inhale through the nose. Exhale through the mouth. Inhale through the nose. Exhale through the mouth. Just be still, be aware. Hold your prayer or your healing request in your heart. Silently, repeat, I am surrounded by the white light of the Lord Christ, of the Lord Buddha, of Lord Rama, of Master Kotumi, I'm surrounded by the white light of Archangel Raphael. Only good shall come to me. Only good shall go from me. I am surrounded by the white light of the Christ, of the Buddha, of Rama, of Kutumi. Of the Archangel associated with healing and transmutation, Archangel Raphael. Only good shall come to me. Only good shall go from me. Great architect of the universe. May it be a channel through which the holy ones approach the world. May it be a center of radiation of thy power. Teach me to travel light, that I may better gain the heights and break the bonds that bind. Teach me to give myself entirely to thy service, to attune myself to thy will. Teach me to lay down the small personal life for the greater cosmic life, and to love with the love of God. Om Ram Ramaya Namaha. Lord Rama, we humbly invoke and ask for blessings and healing. Master Katumi, we humbly invoke for blessings and healing. Lord Buddha, we humbly invoke for blessings and healing. Lord Christ, Rabbi Yehoshua Bar Miriam, we humbly invoke for blessings and healing. I am surrounded by the white light of the Christ, of the Buddha, of Rama, of Kutumi, Archangel Raphael, we humbly invoke your blessings, your presence. We humbly ask for healing. We are surrounded by your white light. Only good shall come to me. Only good shall go from me. I give thanks. Thanks. And now you get to hear from one of my favorite people, Reverend Tammy.
Good morning, Reverend Greg. It's so good to see you and see everyone else here today.
How are you?
It's a beautiful day. It's a beautiful day. I've been enjoying the oils class with many of you. And wow, it's been such an amazing, amazing experience. So we're gonna have a short talk today, and we're gonna be talking about skepticism, doubt, and faith. And we're really talking about how a healthy dose of questioning is a great tool for developing an understanding of what we believe and know. In other words, when we think we know it all, or we're not willing to question what we believe, or we're not willing to ask some of these hard questions, we're no longer really being open at the top. I want to start off talking about an interesting experience I had. My daughter got married about a year and a half ago, and they had the most extraordinary ceremony, and it was something that the two of them had kind of created. And the idea was that they were going to start the ceremony by coming down the aisle in masks. So they had these really intricate masks on as they came down the aisle. And then as they did their vows to each other, they made a commitment to take off their masks. And that was one of the most amazing parts of the ceremony, because when you think about it, so many of us have on these masks. And we often weave these intricate masks that are our story. And so we create a story based on the experiences that we've had. And when we weave these stories or these masks, what happens is that sometimes when we hear or experience the world, it becomes the way in which we perceive the world. It colors how we interpret everything that's going on around us. So we're not actually seeing things clearly, we're seeing things through this mask filter. And so even though the mask may look intricate and pretty on the outside, we may actually be hiding our real selves behind that. So being skeptical is the idea of recognizing that we have on the mask, but knowing that there is a real self behind it. So we acknowledge the mask and we acknowledge that other people have one, but we actually are listening to people behind there. Now, usually when we talk about talking through filters, I'm usually talking about communication, right? We're communicating with one person to another person, sometimes through this filter. But when we start thinking about the idea of skepticism, it gives us access to a conversation about a deeper communication. And that is a deeper communication between our self, our ego, and looking at our higher self, and having the higher self actually be the one that is creating that conversation. So many of you have heard about Don Miguel Ruiz, who is the author of The Four Agreements. He has another book called The Fifth Agreement. And the fifth agreement is to be skeptical, but learn to listen. He reminds us that to be skeptical is masterful because it uses the power of doubt to discern the truth. So when we hear a message from any source, it's transmitted from someone's mind, from their subjective understanding. We receive that transmission and process it according to our experience. So they're telling us a story, we hear that information, and we filter it past our story about ourselves. So listening with skepticism means that you don't have to believe everything you hear. The truth, with a capital T, doesn't need you to believe it. It's connected with divine reality. So if something is being said or communicated or conveyed, that truth itself doesn't need us to believe it. But lies, on the other hand, they want to force you to believe it, because if we don't believe lies, they have no life. And so we've seen many times in our spiritual path throughout history, there have been powerful forces that have seemed to want to scare us with hellfire or something like that, to believe something that may not be true. But the reality is that lies need you to believe it because it has no truth in of itself, whereas the truth that is of the divine source doesn't need us to believe it because it is itself inherent. So the key to being able to understand the difference between what is true and what is a lie is to go into ourselves and listen to our heart. Listen with our heart. Listen with the ear behind the ear, with the heart behind the heart, to listen from a deep space of our true selves, of our true knowing. And we can listen to every message that is given to us from the outside, and listen to how we are interpreting that. Because so many of the messages that are being delivered to us are not necessarily the truth. So we can listen to the truth from inside of ourselves and know what is actually so. And we look at what is the group consciousness that is being conveyed to us. What are the things that everybody knows? What are the things that we believe because conventional wisdom has it that way? Oh, it's flu season. Oh, the economy is down. Oh, you're too old or too young, or not the right gender or not the right color. Oh, we always do this or we always do that. What are these messages from the universe that are telling us something that is limiting our inherent truth? We can listen to all these messages in the universe that come through news, that come through our parents, that came through churches, that comes from any source. and compare it to the truth within us. And then we can look at what is it that we believe about us in relationship to that. So I remember when I was young, my mother used to tell me I remember one time I got a C in math, and I was an A student, so I was devastated. And she told me, oh, don't worry about that. We don't do math, meaning we as Black women don't do math. Well, we all know that's not true. And so I had to look at what were the messages that she received that had her say that. I don't think she would say that now, but she said it then. And what do I believe about myself that would have me believe that message, right? Now, if I believe that message, I can look at a lifetime of being able to have a story about to myself about that, that will have me live out that process. And so I can give you an example of when I wasn't so successful in ignoring that. I remember years ago, I walked into a college classroom and I walked into the wrong room, right? So I looked at the thing wrong and it had the wrong room number on it. So I made up a story about myself that I'm prone to make mistakes. So I should always double check myself, right? To avoid embarrassment and humiliation. So I see myself as a pattern constantly double checking, right? So I was going into the Zoom room for our oils class, and I was probably 5 or 10 minutes early and the room wasn't open. And my first instinct was to double check that I had it right, right? Now, that was a story I made up about myself that, you know, there's nothing wrong with double checking. But in that moment, when I double checked, I had a moment of panic, like, oh, am I in the wrong place? Right. And so what I did was I noticed that that was a mask that I had created for myself. And so what we do when we encounter that mask or that story we have, the first thing I think is important to do is to not judge ourselves wrong for having it. Right. Because the reason why I created that particular story about myself was because I didn't want to make that mistake again. Right. But for it to continue to cycle in my life, it was important for me to say, why do I have that story? And what do I think is true about myself that has me constantly double checking? And what has me have this moment of fear thinking, oh, am I in the wrong place? All right. So that little moment right there, that introspection had me say, when I felt that pang of fear or that brief moment of panic, instead of just going along with that panic, was to have that moment of self-introspection, to have that moment of skepticism. And instead of judging myself, I had an opportunity to say, that's interesting. That's interesting. So skepticism isn't looking at your bride or the groom who's wearing a mask opposite of you, the bride and groom both being within ourselves. The key is to notice that there's the mask, and to view it with skepticism, that whatever we said about ourselves is not necessarily the truth. And with that skepticism, we can look inside of ourselves and realize that we created a filter. So in that space of knowing that we created the filter, I know that I am, is who I actually am. And so then I can put myself in a space of oneness and know that I am whole. I can be in that space and know that I am whole and perfect and complete. And so spirit, connecting myself with who I really am, has me drop that mask. It has me drop that filter. And it allows a space of wholeness, of oneness to emerge. And just as we have our stories about ourselves, as I mentioned, you know, people will tell us their stories. And often people, the stories that people are telling us are stories about themselves. We choose what we believe. So we tell ourselves our own stories, we listen to those, and we don't have to believe those either. So what do we do when we pray? What if we have been saying a prayer and we feel that our prayer hasn't been answered yet? Do we have some sort of inner tyrant that says that there is a God outside of us that is answering someone else's prayers but not answering yours? Is there a part of us that would believe that? And what do we believe about ourselves that we would be willing to accept that lie? What is the most important part about skepticism is realizing that our belief is up to us, and that believing is an expression of faith, but it is not faith. Believing is an intellectual assent. So when we realize that believing is not faith, it's an expression of faith, we can go into what is our faith and go into our heart and remember that we are connected in one with divine presence, and that that presence is only love for me. And so then my mind comes into alignment with the deepest truths of consciousness. And inside of that deepest truth of consciousness, I'm able to bring myself and my belief into alignment with who I am. So we hold our own questioning with skepticism. We cannot possibly believe that the universal presence will answer one prayer but not grant another. And in fact, that whole idea is superstition. So if we feel that we are separated from God, if we feel that there's some separation or some reason, we have to look at what we think that is. Is there something about me that's unlovable? And we have to realize that that is a lie that has to be believed in order for it to exist. Because the truth is that I am the love of God. I am the love of God. I am one with the love of God. So there cannot be any part of me that is missing love. And so that truth is a universal foundational truth. And anything other than that is a belief that I have to believe in order for it to exist. We can either use or lose our faith. It's easy to rest in our faith when all goes well. But sometimes when we have a real test of our faith, it comes at times when life is difficult or disaster strikes. And it's then that it's so important for us to be still. We pray, Lord, I believe, help thou my unbelief. Because all of the things that are the messages of the world, if we believe that they are working for us, we know that they exist so that we can have this powerful experience of light and power. And inside of this power experience, we go through life. And we realize that our faith, no matter what is happening in our lives, is a personal experience. It's an experience of divine self as we express it. That faith cannot be imposed on us. It comes from experience of numosity. This numinosity, that welling of spirit within us, is so subjective within us, it's so uniquely us that it cannot be externally generated. So no person can make you have faith. No person can make you believe. Only we can believe in this presence within us that is the faith of God. Khalil Gibran says, that this is knowledge within the heart beyond the reach of proof. Knowledge within the heart beyond the reach of proof. That means that we know that we know that we know what is so. And we know from the deepest senses of ourselves that that is so. And then the world and its creation comes into alignment with that. Ernest Holmes, in a book called Living Science of Mind, he's the creator of religious science. He says the only way faith is generated is by the communion of the soul with its source, which fans the spark of faith in a divine blaze, and in whose light dark shadows no longer lurk. This illumination, this is the perception of wholeness. So we realize that as we believe, so it is. As we believe, on the power of the light, so it is. As we believe that we are surrounded by the divine light of the Christ, so it is. As we believe and know that we are one and connected with divine light and power, so it is. And so as we focus on this source through our regular meditation, our prayer, our oils, our spiritual study, our healing protocols, our contemplation, as we develop, we find that what we believe in expands as our faith expands. So we are no longer tethered to the messages of the race consciousness of the world around us. We are actually able to develop our capacity to transmute the fear into a higher energetic thought of life, of light, of the genius within us. It all transcends to a higher level. We become engaged in an alchemy, a mental alchemy of transmuting the lower base thoughts of fear and greed, of separation, and we transmute it into the oneness and the light of the divine. And this alchemy is the transmutation of our soul, it is the evolution of our consciousness, and it is the next step in our humanity. So as we are able to embrace the skepticism of our own stories, embrace our skepticism of the stories and the messages of life around us, we align ourselves with this divine presence, and we're able to hear clearer and clearer what spirit is telling us. We're able to be present to greater possibilities and to believe them because we know that they come from a source of truth. So the mental ascent of belief transforms into a higher energy form. So when we know that our prayers are willing something to happen, it casts doubt into the face of all that seems to be. Our will, our belief, becomes transmuted into creating something so much more powerful than we ever thought we would. So what we're doing is we're training ourselves to move from a space of being subject to the contagion of fear, which is all around us, to being able to see through these things to the spiritual truth. So we are in a process of retraining our brains. We're in the process of releasing limitations. We're in the process of rewiring the things that have been our instinct to fear, our instinct to react, our fight or flight responses of our amygdala. And we're moving to a different area of our brain. We're rewiring every part of us so that we are brought more and more into an alignment of knowing that we are one with this greater source and that we are one with everything around us. It's called a spiritual practice because we have to keep practicing it. We practice the changing of our minds and we practice the restructuring of our brains. We practice a deepening of our consciousness. And this is a higher evolution. We are in the practice of causing an intention to remap our very selves, these bodies that we live in, all our energy bodies, our mental bodies, our psychology, the way that what's in our blood, the steps we take, the way we breathe. We're restructuring everything inside the divine highest intent of the Creator. We become co-creators with the creators, with the Creator as we bring ourselves into alignment. And so we are changing our instincts from the reptilian brain about survival to a highest consciousness, and we are evolving into this higher being, one that, like the gods, knowing good from evil, is able to create in the face of all that is. We are evolving into being creators. And doubts about this ability are beliefs and thoughts that can be changed. Earlene Chaney in Degree 1, Lesson 8 says, let it be said that faith is not always acquired without pain. The strain upon the soul is sometimes tense and terrifying. Faith usually unfolds slowly. Once it is born in the human breast, however, the growth is as sure as God himself. Like the mustard seed, it unfolds into a vine to fill the entire being. So that's what we are in the process of doing. We are in the process of unfolding and unfolding this vine of faith that comes from the source of God. And it is filling our entire being. It takes time to acquire this faith because in the process of this, we are having beliefs that have to be subjectively rooted. So what we're looking at is as we view with skepticism these masks, is we are objectively and intellectually accepting and changing the way that we think and believe. We're changing what we think and what we believe in. And so our will and our belief become in alignment. Our divine will and our divine belief become in a divine alignment for our spiritual affirmation for our good. This living word is rooted deep in our consciousness and vines up through our entire being. So if we find that our will is not working for us on some level, the key is not to grit our teeth and gut it out, because our will is our agent, not the source. We don't gut out our will, we connect with divine expression and bring our beliefs into alignment and then have our will be an exercise of this divine presence. Because will is an indication of intelligence. It is connected to divine intelligence. So we connect with divine spirit and have it transform our will so that it supports the highest of our faculties. So if our belief is flagging, if life is hard, or things are not going the way we want them to, the key is not to tell ourselves a story that we can't believe. The key is not to trick ourselves into believing the truth of life. The idea is to root ourselves deeply in the peace that passes all understanding, to root ourselves deeper and deeper and deeper in that. And every time we fall away from that deepest truth, forgive ourselves, look with compassion at our own masks, look at compassion at the masks of others, and say, I forgive 70 times seven, and I go back to my center core. And from that space, I allow my intelligence to align itself with that consciousness. We do not let up, we do not give up, and we do not shut up until we are lifted up in our faith. We reach an awareness that we know that we know that we know, and we speak our faith, we speak our word without doubt. We may meet difficulties, uncertainties, and doubts, barriers walling our passage, but we cannot be discouraged when we're confronted. We must climb over the rocks of unbelief, pass around the barriers of doubt, and plunge into the stream with faith. The stream will ever widen. The barriers will gradually disappear. Though we walk through the plains and valleys of indecision and doubt, the stream will still carry us back to the ocean of our being. And that's also a quote from Holmes. So what we do is we tap into our source. We tap into our source to claim our vision. We tap into our source to reclaim the truth about who we really are. So as we continue in our practicing, it's important that we do a self-assessment. What are my masks? And what do I believe? And reassess every single belief we have in light of the faith and the light and the beauty of the divine, knowing that there is no other truth but this truth of the divine, and all other lies without my attention, without my belief, will fade away into nothingness. Namaste.
Thanks, Reverend Tammy. That was a great talk. Let's take a few moments and just reflect quietly on the words of Reverend Tammy. We will use a short practice that enhances our pursuit of truth. Put your awareness on your heart. With your awareness on your heart, I will chant Om Namah Shivaya. Keep your eyes closed. Om Namah Shivaya. Om Namah Shivaya. Om. Om Namah Shivaya. Om. Om Namah Shivaya. Om. Thank you. gently with all your fingers, below your toes. When you're searching for truth, one of the things that you can do is hold it in the heart. Heart will help let go of the things that are inaccurate and help emphasize things that are accurate. This is more of an energetic approach that augments the things that Reverend Tamay was talking about. We also chant Om Namah Shivaya. It's creative destruction. It is purification. If you don't like Om Namah Shivaya, you could chant Amen. It has a similar effect. It's why we end prayers with Amen, Amin, Amon, Amen Ra. Thank you for joining us on this Sunday session. And from all of us at Astara, we love you and thanks for joining us. Take care. See you soon.
Have a good week.